Okay, brothers and sisters, let's begin with a word of prayer. Dear Father in heaven, we are so thankful for this morning, for the new week, for the opportunity to once again open your word, and we ask for your Holy Spirit to speak to us. Give us clear and understanding minds and an open heart. And we ask, Lord, that you can correct us whenever we are in error. And we pray, Lord, that as we continue to look at the messages here in your word, that we can understand them for ourselves so that we can share them with others. Thank you for hearing our prayer. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. So, this was, good morning, everyone. So this was all what we're looking at here. This was the question on Thursday morning. And we had spent a great deal of time looking at Judges chapter 1, verse 16. And we saw that this had a connection to Deuteronomy 34, verse 3. And we could see that both of those created, if we take chapter 1, verse 16 as the 16th day of the first month. And so as that symbol, and also then we can see it's 161 days, it symbolizes that, just as Deuteronomy 34:3 is a symbol for the natural division of the 777-day period from November 9th to December 25th. And we had also looked at 2 Kings chapter 25, verse 2, and Jeremiah 52, verse 5, that share the same verse dealing with the siege. So these are natural divisions of this 777 days. And the question at the end of that study was, is there any other natural division that we could use to divide these 777 days? So I produced this extremely complex chart, and I know it's not the easiest thing to look at, but we'll first look at this side on the right. So we got November 9th here on the left, December 25th on the right, so that's the center of this chart. And we can see here we have the 252, the 525, the 434, the 343, and the 616, and the 161. So the next natural division to me would be March 27th, 2021, in that we have already divided the days in this manner. And the significance of this here is, well, there's a couple of things. So one, even though these are days, we can look at them as periods of weeks. So for instance, if we were to take 434 days, that's going to be 62 weeks, the 70-week prophecy, and 343 days is going to be 49 weeks, 7 times 7 times 7 days. 616 is 88 weeks. So, you know, and I probably should have somewhere in here where I put all these divisions of weeks. And then 161 days is 23 weeks. So, of course, that's a symbol of the 2300 days. 504 days, of course, is just going to be 72 weeks. That's going to be a double of this 36 weeks for the 252 days. And 273 days is going to be 39 weeks, right? So it's just 3 extra weeks from the 252 days. So now we see this significance, though, of dividing these days as weeks. Now, we know that this structure here, this 63 days on either side of November 9th, becomes part of a structure. It connects back to the 126 days from June 9th to October 13th, 2018. And this 329 days in between. So remember, June 9th is the 9/11 prayer, that closes the Sabbath, closes the camp meeting, so to speak, in 2018. And this would be the camp meeting in Italy. And the next day they have meetings. Now, Stephen, were you there?
Yes.
Okay. So what were the meetings on June 10th? Because that's where Parminder presented time setting, correct?
I remember, I can't remember exact day, but yes, I remember he presented there in 2018.
Yeah, it was the Sunday. It was the day after, because that's where Daniel from Brazil counted the 126 days. So he did an ordinal count. October 13th would have been the 126th day from the 10th of June, and it's the cardinal count from the 9th of June. So, and there was problems recording those meetings or something like that. That I remember that I heard about. It was hard to get copies of them. They had some problems. But anyway, June 9th becomes a symbol of when this movement, it's closing the Sabbath and opening up to June 10th, but it becomes a symbol of when we have this division between the movement time setting and not time setting, or the other way around. And then October 13th, that's me at Lambert Church while Daniel is doing his presentation, Daniel from Brazil, and I'm counting 391.5 days, which you see up here, to November 9th. And September 7th, 2019, that's when Jeff wakes up, and he's presenting in Arkansas. I'm in Canada, but I'm in Warburg Church doing the calculation of the 63 days to November 9th, which is 9 times 7. So that's going to be 9 weeks to November 9th when Jeff is presenting here. And then the center of this 329 days is March 27th, 2019. So that's the center of this chiasm. And we had already had March 27th, 2021 as a division of the 777 days from November 9th to December 25th. So having this other March 27th seemed to me significant. Now, the interesting thing that happened on this date, maybe not for anyone else, but for me, is on March 27th, 2019, I got a Skype call from Odilio. It's the first time I ever talked to him. And he was urging me to not reject July 18th. He said that he had been doing studies on July 18th and he believed it to be true. And he was concerned because I was no longer presenting on it, because Tabo had forbid me from presenting on July 18th. I was no longer doing presentations on it, though I was studying it and I hadn't rejected it. But to me it was, if the movement accepts it, then that's fine. If the movement didn't accept it, that wasn't something for me to push. But Odilio was urging me to do more on it. So that's when him and I begin this studying. It's also, Jeff did the presentation called 1863 on that day. It's the second last presentation of the week because it's a Wednesday. He did a Thursday morning presentation. And then it's going to be on the camp meeting that follows, starting, I believe, on Sunday, where he hands the torch over to Parminder. So that's going to happen in the middle of this period from October 13th to September 7th. Now, of course, we're relating this because we're doing a study in the book of Judges, right? So I'm going through a lot of this detail, and some of it's review to people. Some people aren't familiar with all of this. So I want to ask the question, why is this important? I mean, we have these divisions of this 777 days. And in the book of Judges here, we have this symbolism now that jumps out at us And why am I then going over all of this old history? And we're going to look at it a bit more, but just before we do that, just what is it relating to that we're studying in the book of Judges? Just to kind of get our minds back in the book of Judges. Because what is Judges chapter 1? What is it?
It's a review.
It's a review, right? Okay. And it's in a review that happens in a particular context. And what is the context? Chapter 1, verse 1, first four, five words, six words, I guess, if you count the word of.
Talks about what's going on after the death of Joshua, about claiming the land.
Okay, so it's after the death of Joshua. So we're going to be in this situation where Joshua has died, and now they're going to review. Is that what this movement is doing? Is that where we are at presently?
I think there's a couple.
Okay.
I think there's a couple of points here.
Okay.
We are in a time period very much like the children of Israel were after the death of Joshua. Yes. Mm-hmm. Because right now Elder Jeff is no longer presenting. Mm-hmm. But we are also very much like the corporate church in the situation that this is our opportunity to understand the first, second, and third angels' messages, to give a presentation of this to the world, which the church has not done. Mm-hmm. So understanding the time periods and understanding the symbolism is going to be very important for us.
Mm-hmm.
The 777, like the 490, is something that many within the world would not understand. But when we're looking at a chart like this, we're seeing various waymarks, not only with a primary, a secondary, and a tertiary confirmation,
mm-hmm.
but we're going even much deeper than this.
Mm-hmm.
So, yes, there's a lot to take in, but there's a lot here that needs to be addressed.
Yeah, and because this history is important, to know that God has been leading us.
Yes.
Yeah. Now, so we have this right side, which I think we can all really readily agree upon.
Sure.
Now, we have on this left side some things that we do agree upon as well. I mean, we know about, at the top here on the left, just to make this bigger for people, we have the camp meeting in Italy again.
Right.
And it's a period of 7 days. It begins June 2nd. Which is 252 days after September 23rd. Now, September 23rd is me presenting at Lambert Church the symbol of July 18th July 18th from Samuel Snow's letters as a symbol of the prediction before midnight. And so that happens to be 777 days before November 9th. But it's also 252 days before June 2nd. So we can see that the significance there has to do with the line on the right, which is that division we have of the 252 and the 525. It's just here on this part, we have these 7 days sort of separated out from the 518, because we have Jeff's 9/11 prayer, closing the camp meeting, closing the Sabbath. But we can see, obviously, this is significant, that the start of this camp meeting is significant, and we've had that before. But September 23rd isn't generally understood in the movement. That is, I'm sure if we polled the people who profess to be in this movement, much less than half of them would even know about it. Right. So to know about September 23rd, 2017, as part of our structure, it's not well understood. It's not well known. And it wasn't readily accepted by the movement prior to July 18th, even though I presented that to Jeff on April 26th, 2020. He never did address it. So to me, it was an important part of this movement, this September 23rd date, because it's a failed prediction, a Protestant prophecy using Revelation chapter 12 that has the right idea, but picks the wrong event, just as we did with our dates. Now, the next one below that, the 385 days, that's 55 weeks to October 13, 2018, which of course is where we get the 391.5. So it's really 392 days if you're counting from the beginning of October 13th to the beginning of November 9th. But remember, this is counting from noon October 13th to midnight commencing November 9th. So it's 391.5, a half a day less. So it's from noon to midnight. And then below it, well, we have 55 weeks here above it. This is 550 days. And this is that center date, March 27th, between October 13th and September 7th, 2019, October 13th, 2018. And so, so this here is just another division of this period of time, but it relates to this division. So there's a relationship here. And then this one is interesting. Again, for me, November 2nd is the date that I happened to apply Josiah Litch's prophecy to arrive at July 18th, 2020. So prior to that, so this is a Friday. The previous Friday, Heidi and I were shopping at Walmart because we would go to town on Fridays to do shopping. And we were shopping at the Walmart. And I'd figured this, that July 18th, based on the prophecy of Josiah, so using Ezekiel chapter 4, I'd come up with the date July 18. Now, it was a Julian date, but we still applied it to the Gregorian date. That is, we still took it as a symbol and placed July 18th there on the line, but we weren't using Josiah Litch's prophecy. We were using Ezekiel. So a week later, I came up with, and I had some email exchange with Stephen that I can't find, and hopefully he can find it and send it to me so I can get how we did this. But in the main thing that I was doing here was looking at all the 26 days of the fourth month. And then I recognized the 26th day of the fourth month was also July 18th. So I knew the 10th day of the fifth month was July 18th, Julian in 2020, which was July 31st. But it was on this date that I recognized the 26th day of the fourth month was July 18th, Gregorian. The 26th day of the fourth month and the 10th day of the fifth month being 13 days apart, just as the Julian Gregorian calendars are in our time. Now, you'll see, of course, here that the interesting division of this is that 405 days is an inversion of 504 days, and 372 is an inversion of 273. So this ties these two lines together in this very mirror-like way. And so in some ways, when we're looking at this, we can see that this is a mirror. This November 9th becomes the center of this mirror. We can see it here, of course, but we can see it in this line as well. And then the significance of November 2nd as a symbol, Stephen Jameson, in 2018, he turned 49 on February 11th, which is an inversion of November 2, and they happen to be 264 days apart. So so that's a very interesting symbol as well. And it's Stephen and I that worked on this using Josiah Litch's prophecy to come to July 18th. So in reviewing this, we can see when we're looking at the book of Judges, chapter 1, it's speaking to this movement, and it's showing us that God has been leading in how we came to the dates that we have. And we can't abandon, especially at this time, these dates. And we're going to see in the book of Judges, we're going to see the movement abandoning its message. So I think that's the significance of why that symbol is there in Judges chapter 1, verse 16, and why it leads us back to the 777 structure and to our history, something that we can't neglect. Any questions on this before we hand it back to Dwight, even though he's not in his chair yet? Any thoughts on this?
372 times 7 is the prophetic mirror is 2604.
Okay. So 372 times 7 is 2604. So that's, of course, pretty interesting from the point that we already have that 264 tied to your birthday in 2018. And of course, it's the 49th birthday, which is significant in connection to the 777 structure. So you're saying 372 times 7 equals 2604. And that's a symbol, of course, of the 26th day of the fourth month, as well as the length of the prophetic mirror from 742 BC to 1863. Yeah, so thanks for that. So I need to take a note of that. I don't want to forget that one.
On September 23rd was the date when in the Julian calendar that Ezekiel finished the 40 days lying on his right side in 591.
Okay, yeah, so in 591 BC, you have, so I'm just going to figure this out here. I'm just checking this. So in 591 BC, I'm just going to run away. I'm looking at the Babylonian calendar here right now. And that's going to be, the date that he finishes is going to be August. No, what's the date? September 23rd, you're saying?
Yes, in 591.
Okay, just checking this. Okay, and that's what day on the biblical calendar? So let me think here.
It's the 21st day of the sixth month.
Yeah, okay, so that's correct. Yeah, so September 23rd. Now, September 23rd has another significance because that's a mistaken date, but still a date in Early Writings, page 74. So I've always taken that as a symbol, right? So the Lord showed me that that he would stretch out his hand a second time to recover the remnant of his people. And the date given in Early Writings is September 23rd, but we know that it's actually October 23rd, 1850, not September 23rd, 1850, that she had that vision. But the fact that it's there, even though it's a typo, that's never been noticed except by us, I think becomes extremely important as a symbol. So September 23rd is an important symbol. And yeah, so it's going to be the date that he completes his line, Ezekiel completes his line on his right side after 40 days. And we know that, of course, when he commences lying on his left side and when he ends lying on his left side and when he commences lying on his right side, all of these things are important dates. We have the 5th day of the 4th month, we have the 10th day of the 5th month, we have August 15th and September 23rd.
And the 21st day of the 6th month can connect when Jeff put the advertisement?
Yes. Yeah, and when we count from that date, remember when we count from the date that the ad was put, the ad that, because he had actually put an earlier ad, but it wasn't noticed. But the ad which all the hubbubaloo was made about, that the world we drew their attention, it's 187 days to December 25th bombing in Nashville. So that date becomes significant, not just that it was the publishing of that full page ad in the Tennessean, but also that it's followed by 187 days to the bombing of Nashville. And the 21st day of the 6th month could be connected to the SSL.
Samuel Snow's letter.
Oh, okay. Yeah, I hate abbreviations, but so we can see it as a symbol of February 16th. All right, 216. Okay, so yeah. So there are lots of different things, and it's also a symbol of the 126 as well, because Samuel Snow's letter is a symbol of that. You just put 6 month, 21st day, and then read it backwards. So those are really interesting observations that we have here. And of course, you know, looking at all these different symbols, the number of weeks, and that was the other thing here, January 11th. If you remember, if you took September 7th, November 9th, and January 11th as just numbers, 9, 7, 11, 9, and 1, 111, and you added them together, they would give you the number 327, which would be March 27th, 2021. And that's 63 weeks from January 11th to March 27th. And if we took the Canadian and European way, 7-9, 9-11, and 111, and added them together, you'd get 1001, which is a symbol of January 11th, the starting date of the 63 weeks. So there was lots of different things regarding these weeks. So this is 441 days, which is a mirror of 144. And there's probably other things that, you know, we've missed. But this is our history.
With the 518 days, I just remember that Pope John Paul II was born May 18th. It's not that important, but it stuck out to me.
Yeah, and also in reverse, it's August 15th.
Amen.
Right. So you know, we could probably spend a bit more time on this, but the point is being made. So I can stop the share, and Dwight, you can share what you have.
Okay. Kind of intriguing when you go back through the numbers and the way that that all of this is now interrelated.
Yeah, well, and that's always been the amazing thing for me, because I mean, I've seen them unfold as time has gone on, but it's the interrelationship of all of these structures in just multiple ways that just fascinates me. I mean, just from an intellectual point of view, just how you could even have such structures. And so, you know, it's, you know, and just another thing here, see this the 329 days between October 13th and September 7th.
All right.
If we go to the whole structure, that is, we go back to the start of this, which is the Mayan date of December 21st, 2012, to the December 25th date, 2021, it's 3,291 days. So it's 10 times 329. The center date being June 22nd. So a symbol of FFA. So this is just part of this structure. There's more to the structure. And this structure also relates to the other things that we have found relating to the 2030 date as well. So there's all kinds of interconnectedness that is, it's a complex tapestry. It's wheels within wheels in ways that I don't think any single person could fully comprehend. But God's given it to us as a witness, and it helps us understand Judges, where we are in the book of Judges. So
it's amazing that we're getting this all really from the study of the first portion of the first chapter of Judges.
Yeah.
Okay. So brief review. As Theodore was saying, Judges 1:16 has given us some great light. And the children of the Kenite, Moses' father-in-law, went up out of the city of palm trees with the children of Judah into the wilderness of Judah, which lieth in the south of Arad. And they went and they dwelt among the people. So it's intriguing that we have here the children of the Kenite, Moses' father-in-law, who is named in the Bible Jethro and Hobab. Now, why would he be recognized with two names? That's the question I keep looking at. And I have not yet really centered as to why he was being named with two names.
Yeah, and nobody has an answer to that I've seen. They just note that it's the case.
But it's also that he is given, that he is a child of the Kenite, but he's also of the family of Midian. Mm-hmm. So it's a further division. Now, in this situation, Moses' father-in-law was looked upon as being a very wise man, because he is the one that when he came to Moses, as the children of Israel had left Egypt, his comment to Moses was that he was wearing himself out and that he should divide the responsibility of hearing all of what was going on with the different tribes. So there is some symbolism here that possibly we need to look at a later time. So Judges 1:17, and Judah went with Simeon his brother, and they slew the Canaanites that inhabited Zephath and utterly destroyed it. And the name of the city was called Hormah. So when we look back within Scripture, Hormah is noted in Numbers and it's noted in Joshua. Because in Numbers 21, verse 3, and the Lord hearkened to the voice of Israel and delivered up the Canaanites, and they utterly destroyed them and their cities. And he called the name of the place Hormah. So this destruction occurred as Moses was leading the children of Israel. And then in Joshua, we come and we note the different cities that are being given to the different tribes, because here in Joshua 19, Hormah is one of the cities then being given. Now, in that portion, in Joshua 19, Hormah is being shown as part of the inheritance for Simeon. So, why the interrelation, the call out of this verse, that Hormah was known as Zephath as well, but for how long? I mean, we're really not being given an answer here, but the city has been known now as Hormah and as Zephath. And when we see a change of name, the normal way we would approach this is that this is a covenant. Right? I mean, Abram to Abraham, Sarai to Sarah. Those were covenants, and they were symbols of covenants when the names were changed. So the children of the tribe of Simeon are going to inhabit this city, and they are calling it Hormah. Is there a difference in the meaning of Hormah from that of Zephath? What do we see? I mean, Hormah, Cormah, Hebrew 2767, is from the Hebrew 2763, or devoted. But as was pointed out before, is this devoted as in that it is a place set aside, or is this devoted as in a place noted for destruction, as we would have applied it under the story of Achan? What do you think? Because Zephath, as we were talking about, would mean watchtower. Hormah, devoted, or is it devoted to destruction?
Well, I think devoted to destruction.
Okay. So the children of Israel were being called upon to destroy the Canaanite watchtower, which was devoted to destruction.
Okay, now, I just want to go back here. So I did a little bit of research here on this. Judges 4 verse 11. So the word there that says, that's translated as father-in-law.
Yeah.
Can be translated various ways. It can actually even mean son-in-law.
Interesting.
It basically refers to an in-law. So, if we look at Numbers, which one is it? Numbers 10:29.
Do you want to bring that up on the screen?
Okay. So Numbers 10:29, and Moses said unto Hobab, the son of Reuel, the Midianite, Moses' father-in-law. So we know Reuel is another name for Jethro. And Hobab is the son of Reuel or Jethro. So he would be Moses' brother-in-law, not father-in-law. So Judges 4 verse 11 is just translated incorrectly. And the also you have Hobab travels with Moses when Jethro goes back. So Hobab is there, Jethro isn't there. So it can't be referring to Jethro.
Okay. It
would be his brother-in-law.
I stand corrected.
Yeah, well, it took a little bit of research, but it's the Bible.
That's great.
People had different opinions about it, but it's the Bible verses themselves and just looking at the Hebrew word the way it's translated. So yeah, it's translated as son-in-law, to make oneself a daughter's husband. Wife's father, wife's mother, father-in-law, mother-in-law. So it's got different, it's a type of in-law in some way. So anyway, hopefully that's helpful.
So, well, we still stand with the situation then. We have Reuel, also Jethro. So we have a man with two names.
Yeah.
We have Hobab as Moses' brother-in-law, not his father-in-law.
Yeah. At least, you know, just that's my initial. I haven't looked in the Spirit of Prophecy yet to see what she says about it. But different people have different opinions, of course.
Okay.
She doesn't mention Hobab, so, well, maybe she does. Maybe I'm not looking in the right spot. Just hang on. Okay, so she might just quote the verse, though. Oh. Well, here's what Ellen White says.
Okay.
But while inflicting judgment, God remembered mercy. The Amalekites were to be destroyed, but the Kenites who dwelt among them were spared. This people, though not wholly free from idolatry, were worshippers of God and were friendly to Israel. Of this tribe was the brother-in-law of Moses, Hobab, who had accompanied the Israelites in their travels through the wilderness, and by his knowledge of the country had rendered them valuable assistance. So she says it's his brother-in-law.
Okay, now isn't that passage coming from about the time of Saul? Or am I confusing things?
Yeah, this is when Saul's rejected, but she's okay. Going to say of this tribe was the brother-in-law of Moses, Hobab.
Right.
So, yeah, so she's talking about the time when the Amalekites are going to be destroyed and the Kenites are going to be preserved.
Okay.
But yeah, so it's definitive then. So my initial search was correct. Okay, and I'll stop sharing.
Okay. So the watchtower is destroyed. Hormah, which was devoted to destruction, then becomes a city of those of Simeon. Now in the chat, there was a comment that was made. Comment says, it intrigues me that Kenaz, the Kenites, has a meaning of hunter, to hunt. And we have Jeremiah 16:16, which is a doubling, about hunters and fishers. And then the application is being made with 161 and 661 in the reference.
Probably should be 61.
Yeah.
616, yeah. Okay.
Yeah, that's what I figured.
Well, I'd rather have the clarification.
Yeah.
You know, sometimes we post and our fingers get a little faster than our minds are recognizing?
I'm a horrible typist.
Okay. So we're being shown that the children of Raul, of the Midianites, through Hobab, Moses' brother-in-law, are providing a service throughout the time that the children of Israel are coming through the promised land, because he understands where they're to go and he has knowledge of the country. Now, as we come further, also Judah took Gaza with the coast thereof, and Ascalon with the coast thereof, and Ekron with the coast thereof. As we pointed out last week, these are three cities that became known as being three of the five Philistine cities. Now here in Judges 1:19, the opposite of 9:11, and the Lord was with Judah, and he drave out the inhabitants of the mountain, or he possessed the mountain, but could not drive out the inhabitants of the valley because they had chariots of iron. Nine-11 is a point that we have made many times as being really the revealing of the Revelation 18 angel and the reintroduction of both the first and the second angel's message. But why was Judah unable to drive out the inhabitants of the valley? What was our conversation on this?
A lack of faith in God. They're walking by sight of iron chariots, which to me, I was wondering if that was referring to the papacy and its link with the U.S. military.
Okay. Is this also very directly a lack of faith in the word of God?
Well, yeah.
So in other words, if we have no faith directly in the word of God, we have no faith in the promise of God, therefore we have no faith in the character of God.
All three of those compute.
So if we have no faith in these three steps, how can we then walk through the sanctuary with the expectation of being judged and being shown to be worthy for the kingdom to come? To me, this situation with Judah, just like when I look at the situations with many of the other tribes, is a very personal, finger pointed by three at me. I can't point a finger at a situation without having three fingers pointed back at me. Here is Judah. They drove out the inhabitants of the mountain, but they didn't trust God enough to believe his word and his character that he would go before them to drive out those that had the chariots of iron. the point looking at this as the U.S. military may also be correct. But where is our faith? Are we trusting in what we see, or are we trusting in the promise that we have been given?
A lot of eyes are looking at the things that are developing around us, whereas our goal and our object should not be that. It should be what you're describing, is having the faith of what it's telling us, not necessarily what we're seeing, because we can see one thing, but it's like looking through a forest to find a tree. You can't see the tree because of the forest, right?
Right.
Well, that's what we need to, that's what we're doing now, is we are whittling down that forest so we can see that tree. Right? I mean, that's what we're doing. We're trying to figure out what's going on. Isn't that the goal of this whole thing, is to try to figure out where we are, what we're supposed to be doing, the message that we're supposed to be giving? Are these things just, you know, imagination, or is this what we're doing?
This is what we're supposed to do.
I'm right there with you, brother. This is what we're supposed to be doing. And however it turns out, is how it's going to turn out.
Well, I'll give you an example. I received a telephone call late last evening. Now, this is from a friend that had moved from Idaho to Kentucky. And it was late my time on the West Coast when he called. But we were in a conversation for pretty much over an hour. And his whole focus is, when did the second angel's message end originally? So we address that. Well, why are we not giving the third angel's message? And he was trying to tell me how Walter Veith is doing a wonderful job giving the third angel's message. And I was shaking my head at that, because Walter Veith is not a friend of this movement. At this point, September 11, 2001, is a symbol of the revelation of the angel of Revelation 18. We need to understand the first and second angel's message in order to truly be able to give the third. And the point that I was making throughout this is, with the book of Judges, we are seeing elements that are helping us to understand more clearly what the third angel's message is to be. The third angel's message initially was begun to be recognized in 1844. Yet when the third angel's message was presented in order to be formalized, it was rejected in 1888. And Mrs. White is very clear that had Christ himself stood before that general conference session, they would have crucified him anew, just as the Jews had done in 31 AD. That for me was a very sad reference, that they understood their message so little that if the Savior himself had been before them, they would have chosen to crucify him. It's no different than looking at this right now. That they're
very sobering, you know.
It is very sad. But what the brother had said was that this is a very sobering thought.
Absolutely.
Now, it's sobering as well that the children of Israel could accomplish much, but did not accomplish all that they were set out to do because of their lack of faith. There stand I, except for the grace of God. So I look at this and I accept it as a very personal message. Judges 1:20. And they gave Hebron unto Caleb, as Moses said, and he expelled thence the three sons of Anak. Okay, Hebrews 6:6. Why? In the chat.
Well, actually, I should have put Hebrews 6:4 to 6. For it is impossible for those who were once enlightened and have tasted of the heavenly gift and were made partakers of the Holy Ghost and have tasted the good word of God and the powers of the world to come, if they shall fall away, to renew them again unto repentance, seeing they crucify to themselves the Son of God afresh and put him to an open shame. It's referring to what you're talking about regarding 1888.
But 1888 is also being repeated again in this history.
Amen.
Okay. So when I look at the error that was made then, and I'm comparing it with some of the things that we have seen today, especially with many of the things that we have seen from Parminder and Tess and the fractions that we're seeing within the movement, again, Christ is being crucified again afresh. The disciples had gone through the literal crucifixion and were left discouraged and scared, because they understood not what was going to happen then. On the day of resurrection, they became even more confused because they had not taken to heart the word of the Savior. When they began to realize that he was alive, that one that had been dead was now alive, their confusion grew. And it wasn't until he began to explain to them all of these things that are written of him in the scriptures that the darkness of their minds began to be lifted. The children of Israel were given a territory. All they had to do was believe. And through faith, God was going to lead them to take the territory. But they needed to drive out all of the other peoples that inherited and inhabited this area. When we go through this step by step, we're going to look upon all of the other tribes that could not drive out the other nations from before them. Here is the first, Judah. Judah is given an example through Caleb of what it means to truly have faith, because it was the giants that scared the children of Israel to begin with, so that the 10 came back saying, it's impossible. But it was Caleb and Joshua that came back and said, it's more than possible. We can drive these out. by faith, we can have this territory. Are we any different today from being able to claim that we are able to give this message, even though it's the message that the church does not wish to see go out? What was it that the leaders of the church were most afraid of in 1888 when they heard the messages of Wagner and Jones and the support that came from Ellen White? What was their biggest concern at that time?
Wasn't it vanity? They didn't want to be wrong or be looked at as being wrong because they were the leadership.
When we study the situation of 1888, the biggest issue that they were concerned with is that they were going to lose control of the people, but specifically that they were going to lose control of the money that was being given.
More concerned about the money than do what's needed to be done.
They were more concerned about the money than they were about the salvation of the members.
Yeah.
I think we can say that money had become their idol.
God or mammon.
Right.
And some of them that took the jab
Okay. Explain your thought, please.
Either do that or lose their job.
Yeah, there's that too.
The ones that took the jab, they either comply or get fired, get let go.
It's been a strange situation for me because I've watched posts of people that I've known for well over 40 years, especially some that are university trained, nurses, etc., that are so blunt that we need to accept man's science. We need to take the jab for the good of everybody, even though it is to the detriment of the person that chooses to accept it. There will be those that are not going to like that comment. And quite honestly, it's to the point for me that I no longer care. Truth has to be told. Truth is not relative. We're either black or we're white. We're either telling the truth or we're not. We either have faith that God is leading and God knows what's best for us, or we believe in man. And if we're believing in man, we're lifting man up as an idol.
Dwight, I don't think it's quite that black and white because, I don't remember Jesus castigating people, but I do remember him, he called people hypocrites. That's a word. But he gave those people that didn't really understand what was really going on, he gave them parables, not necessarily as a smooth thing, but it's something that they can relate to without getting upset because it's just a story. I find that when I speak to people and I talk about the jab, I immediately get a defensive mode projected towards me, because I just flat out say it, you know, I mean, I'm not going to get the jab and there ain't nothing, nobody going to do about it. I don't care if you try to put a gun to my head. It's not going to happen. And then other people automatically get defensive and say, well, I had to do it because, or not necessarily defensive, but, you know, they're trying to explain why they've done it. Personally, I don't care why they've done it. You know, I'm just, to me, that's all I'm telling them is, to me, that's the way it's going to be with me. I don't necessarily care about you in that respect. I do. I can offer you all the information I have about it. But you have to ultimately make that, you know, the decision. And we all are so different. I mean, we all are all so different. And it's hard to relate to people that you're different about, you know, with. So I think all this stuff here is like a training exercise for us to be able to put ourselves in check, to be able to deal with people that are you can be agreeable, or you can disagree without being disagreeable.
Right.
Right. I mean, agreed. that's what we're training for. And Jeff, I remember this very vividly when he was talking about his experiences dealing with the other ministries that he dealt with while he was involved with where he was when he wrote those series of articles that later became published at some great expense, personal expense, via the wearing out of Jeff, per se, to get that stuff done. But he made it clear that, you know, people are different and you have to be able to do it. And some people can't deal with certain types of people. And that's why the need I see of having to have all these bodies around you, because other people can relate to those folks. You know, when you have trouble and an issue, and this is why we're supposed to be discussing these things, we should be coming in, you know, it's like, it is a ministry. And there should be a plan how we deal with these things. It should be like ingrained, but it's really not. And that's what we're doing now, is we're trying to get all that information together so we can deal with this stuff in the near future, which we're going to have to do. It's just all there is to it. Am I right or am I wrong?
I'm not disagreeing with you. In 1863, the church made the choice that they wanted to try to protect their children from having to go to war and from the draft that President Lincoln had instituted. In order to do that, the church decided that they needed to have an official recognition as a church. So they were formed under the laws of the United States as a church, with the intention of protecting their children. Since 1863, the church has gone forward to bend and bend and bend to the requirements of the government. The health message that is currently being given by the corporate church is, we will allow abortion because the government says that we should provide it. We are recommending to follow the advice of the government to accept an untested shot for the good of others. At this point, the church is not standing up. The church has laid down its banner.
Right, when Sunday law comes, it might be laid down for that too.
Exactly. The faith is no longer being shown in God. The faith is being shown in man. I don't disagree.
Mainstream church. I'm sorry. The mainstream church should stand up like the midwives did to Pharaoh to spare the children.
But it hasn't, has it?
Not at all. I was shocked when I came into the church about 30 years ago, and I learned that kind of stuff was going on then. I thought, why? You know, I should have asked then.
So we have choices before us. Are we going to have the faith that we can drive out these giants? Or are we going to be afraid of what the military might do to us? The faith of our fathers, the faith of Luther, of Calvin, Zwingli, all of those that have gone before us, was a faith that even when confronted with death, they stood firm.
Yeah, remember, Luther had to be dragged off by other folks that had his best interest in mind, but he didn't know where he was going or who he thought he was dead, actually.
Well, he also spent time, you know, in a room in a castle translating parts of the Bible. But here was Luther before those that would seek his life. And his comment, "Here I stand, I can do no other," still rings true today, because he was saying that by his faith, his reliance completely upon God, he would stand before priest and prelate and he would stand against what they were teaching. So they gave Hebron unto Caleb, as Moses had said, and he expelled thence the three sons of Anak. What do the three sons of Anak represent? What symbol could we apply to them? What three giant things could we say they represent to us?
The threefold union.
Okay. The three Angela union. First.
That's Ron it. Second. She said it.
Go ahead.
Yeah, I said the beast, the dragon, and the false prophet.
Okay. What about the state of the dead? Sunday sacredness. And what else would we say that this could be? I mean, granted. Beast. Go ahead.
Is this something to do with the health message? Maybe.
I would think it does.
Could it be the loss of the flesh, loss of the eyes, pride of life?
Excellent, yes. These are the things that we need to consider, because Caleb was able to expel these by his faith and his reliance upon God. We need to choose today who is leading us and our house. And the children of Benjamin did not drive out the Jebusites that inhabited Jerusalem, but the Jebusites dwell with the children of Benjamin in Jerusalem unto this day. Now, this particular passage offers a confusion for me. Because when we take a look at what the translators had used as a cross-reference, we come down here and we are told to see Joshua 15:63. As for the Jebusites, the inhabitants of Jerusalem, the children of Judah could not drive them out, but the Jebusites dwell with the children of Judah at Jerusalem unto this day. And Joshua 18:28. And Zelah and Eleph and Jebusi, which is Jerusalem, Gibeah and Kirjath, 14 cities with their villages. This is in the inheritance of the children of Benjamin according to their families. Why is it noted that Benjamin and Judah could not drive out the Jebusites? What lesson is being presented for us here?
Well, the pure message can drive out error.
Okay, let's apply it in this way. And I'm going to take what you just said as part of this. What if this is a warning to the movement? The children of Judah, the greater tribe than Benjamin, could not drive out the Jebusites, as we noted in the book of Joshua. Can we apply that to 1888 and the message of the third angel?
Yeah, seems to be, yeah.
So could we, as the movement, the church today, be represented by the children of Benjamin? I mean, we need to have the faith. Yeah. We need to have the reliance on God to be able to give that third angel's message.
Yeah.
In these situations, God is saying over and over and over again, you need to trust me. As Theodore was showing earlier, with all of these numerical waymarks and placing these situations online, we're seeing the affirmation of the validity of the 777 symbol. We're being shown that God is taking this work into his hands, because you're not going to find any other way where all of these symbols can line up so directly and so clearly as was shown at the beginning of this meeting. Is it just chance that this happens? I mean, I look at these, at all of this, And we're looking at more than a million to one shot. We're looking at not something just highly unlikely, but hugely unlikely that these things are going to line up the way they have. Here we have the children of Judah, the fourth son of Jacob. Their descendants are afraid to drive out those with the iron chariots. It doesn't say that the Jebusites dwelling in Jerusalem had iron chariots, but they failed to drive them out, as did the children of Benjamin. Is this a warning for us that we need to be prepared, not to be afraid, but to go forward with a message that God himself has ordained, and that God will show us how that message is to go? Do we not just need to understand his word so that the message can be presented as clearly as a trumpet call? Consider carefully the failure of these two tribes. Consider directly what this has meant to the children of Israel at that time and what it means to us today. They allowed these other peoples to live among them. And what was the result?
Are we a watering down of, faith?
As we're going to see as we progress through the balance of this chapter. Not only did it water down their faith, but it substantially changed their faith, because the children of Israel did exactly what Joshua was afraid was going to happen. Joshua was aware that these children that he had so lovingly led for 30 years had already in secret begun to practice idolatry.
So how are we looking at this? Are we looking at this for us in a symbolic way or in a literal way? Because it sounds like these children are not necessarily children, but they are the different distractions of belief in our time.
Okay.
That not necessarily people, but the things that we think are from God, which aren't, because we haven't proved them out the way we have been proving them out line upon line.
Well, to answer your question, I'm looking at this from cause to effect.
Mm-hmm.
Joshua was afraid, and he was aware that secretly the children of Israel had begun to practice idolatry. The effect became more readily understood by the time you get to the timing of Ezekiel chapter 8. Now, when we get to Ezekiel chapter 8, Ezekiel is taken back from his point of captivity to the temple, which he knew well. And he gets to see all of the abominations that are occurring. Now, we're going to return to this tomorrow. There's a comment from the chat. I'd like to get into this just briefly. Why is Acts 4:24-35 important at this point?
Well, the first thing that came to me was Acts 4:29, where it says, "And now, Lord, behold their threatenings, and grant unto thy servants that with all boldness they may speak thy word." But then I went up, and this is when the church was receiving a lot of flack from the powers that be damned, as I call them. It says, "Why did the heathen rage?" Like, it's quoting from Psalm 2, right? "And the people imagined vain things. The kings of the earth stood up. The rulers were gathered together against the Lord and against his Christ. For of a truth, against thy holy child, Jesus, whom thou hast anointed, both Herod and Pontius Pilate," you could say the Pope, the President, the Premier, the Prime Minister, whoever, "and Pontius Pilate, with the Gentiles, and the people of Israel," so the church and the state and the people of the world in general, "were gathered together for to do whatsoever thy hand and thy counsel determined before to be done." So we're slated to be persecuted. And then the prayer is, "Now, Lord, behold their threatenings and grant unto thy servants." I think if we realize that they're not fighting against us, they're fighting against Christ. When I hear that, I get angry. I mean, it's righteous anger, right?
Okay.
"By stretching forth thine hand to heal," and so forth, "at signs and wonders." It says, "And when they had prayed, the place was shaken where they were assembled together, and they were all filled with the Holy Ghost, and they spake the word of God with boldness." And then there was unity. "The multitude of them that believed were of one heart and of one soul. Neither said any of them that aught of the things which he possessed was his own, but they had all things common." Now we have the true common good. "And the great power gave the apostles witness of the resurrection of the Lord Jesus, and great grace was upon them all. Neither was there any among them that lacked. For as many as were possessors of lands or houses sold them, and brought the prices of the things that were sold, and laid them at the apostles' feet, and distribution was made unto every man according as he had need." So if we realize who we are in Christ, take his word seriously, depend totally on him, get filled with the Holy Spirit, there's no worldly power that can stand against it. There's no satanic power that can stand against that.
Right. Okay. We've come to the end of our time today. We are going to return to Judges 1:21 tomorrow. Consider carefully the example of Benjamin and that of Judah. Let's address this further. Any other thoughts or any other comments at this time? All right, shall we close with prayer? Gracious Father in heaven, we thank you for these examples of what have occurred before. We take heart that you are showing us that our faith needs to grow. It is not always an easy thing to recognize this. Help thou my unbelief today. Direct us each one. Show us, Father, that which we need to do so that your character may be seen more clearly by all of those with whom we come in contact. Direct us to this end. For this we thank you, and this we praise you, in the name of Jesus. Amen.